Hi, my name is Steve, and my wife Kelly is the force behind this devotional series entitled Lenten Art, a Visual Devotional. In this devotional, there are two basic parts. The first is called the reading. An analysis of art is known as a reading because it is intended to tell a story. In this first part of the devotional, Kelly will provide the needed items of background that will help you to read the painting. The second part is the contemplation. Here Kelly will give you some guidance, but she really wants you to engage with the painting and let it speak to you. Examine the painting, notice the details, read the accompanying passages of scripture, and see where the artist is taking the story, and you'll be surprised that you experience the story of Jesus in a fresh new way. We cover 20 different paintings in the whole devotional. You can use them however you like. If you do 3 for every week of the Lent season, you will complete the 20 before Easter. Thanks for joining us on this tour of Lenten art, and here's Kelly.
Welcome to the Lenten Art Devotional. Today we're going to be looking at an artwork by the artist Enrique Simonet. The name of the artwork in Latin is Flavet Super Lam, and the translation is Then He Wept. The subject matter of the painting is Jesus standing on the Mount of Olives overlooking the city of Jerusalem and crying. And this was the day that he will then proceed on down to Jerusalem and enter the city gates on Palm Sunday, the triumphal entry. So we're moving our way into the last week of Christ's life. Now, the painting was painted by Simonet when he was 26 years old. Before we go on and talk about the theological implications of the painting, I first want to just look at the painting itself. And the first thing that you would notice if you saw the painting hanging in a museum is its size. It's 10 feet by 18 feet, so it's a massive painting. When you look at it on screen, on a computer, it certainly doesn't come across that way. When you even see pictures of it in the museum and context and people standing in front of it, it gives a different impression because you're struck by the size of the work and just you're pulled into the work more because it's so large. So if you can imagine this single large canvas in your mind, 10 feet by 18 feet, that might help you when it comes to contemplating the picture. Also, as he was painting it, he decided not to put the canvas onto a stretcher. You've probably all seen canvases around a wooden frame, like at Michael's or Joann's, that you can purchase to paint. But canvas is generally stretched over something and attached to a wooden frame so that the artist has a taut canvas to paint on. This was a very large canvas, and he opted not to have a stretcher built and attached to the back of it. Part of the reason for this decision was that this piece was going to be shipped internationally into several competitions. And in the end, he would end up winning competitions in Madrid, Barcelona, Chicago, and Paris with this work. And so it was being just rolled up and shipped to the next place, rolled up, shipped to the next place. There are a lot of drips around the bottom of the painting that are both because the way the canvas was hanging and it wasn't the taut canvas, the drips got on the canvas. And also because he figured eventually the painting would be stretched onto a stretcher and then framed, and the frame would cover up a lot of the drippings. But there was one area where the drippings were more noticeable than the rest, and that's on the left-hand bottom corner, where he covered a lot of that with a grouping of thistle. And in that area of the painting is also where he signed the work and wrote in Jerusalem and then Rome and the year. And the reason he wrote Jerusalem and Rome is those are the two places that he composed the work. He composed the work while he was in Jerusalem. The idea came up with the composition, how it would be laid out. And then he painted the painting in Rome. And so he wanted to document the Jerusalem aspect onto the painting itself. If you also look down in that right-hand corner, you'll notice right to the right of the thistles, but still down on the bottom left, in the rocks, there appears to be a skull. I see a skull fairly clearly down there in that bottom rock. And that's a very common device used by artists to show in a painting that death is coming, that there's a transience to life, that nothing is permanent for us as humans because we all reach a point where we die. And in this painting, when we're seeing Christ moving into the last week of his life, having the skull there as a reminder of his impending death makes perfect sense. Now, in this painting, there's some interesting things that the artist has done with paint. In some parts of the work, he's used what is called impasto painting, which is a very thick paint, and it's applied really thickly. So if you walk up to the canvas, you can actually see depth to the paint itself. He uses impasto in areas, particularly the rocks and some of that area, the paint's quite thick. And then in other areas, he's actually taken the paint and diluted it down so it's very translucent, and it gives a, you know, this opaque kind of almost can see back into the canvas so that it's nearly a transparent paint. And that gives us some of the luminosity in the sky that he did that. Unusual to see an artist use both techniques in the same work, but we have that here. Now, Simonet was finishing his studies in Rome when he decided that he wanted to paint this painting on this subject. And he knew he wanted Jesus standing on the Mount of Olives and surveying Jerusalem before him. And so in trying to set up the painting and decide where everything would be, he felt he couldn't do that adequately from pictures of Jerusalem. He needed to go there himself and experience the city, experience the sights and the sounds and the people and how they dressed, and just get a whole feel for the atmosphere around Jerusalem. So that's what he did. And so he traveled into Jerusalem. And one of the things he really wanted to determine while he was there is what the time of day would be when he would set his painting so that it would have the most impact on the viewer, and that the temple of Herod would be accented. Now, the temple wasn't there when he visited. It had been destroyed earlier, but he was imagining the temple and what it would have been looked like when Christ stood there and looked out. So he has chosen to paint the painting in the early morning light, so just as the sun is rising. And the reason for this is that the sun, the way he's painted it, is hitting the temple. So the temple is kind of glowing in the picture, this broad horizontal band in the midground of the painting. And we also, because he's done early morning, have the morning star up above Christ's head in the sky. Now, the morning star is a star. It's actually Venus, so not a star, but a planet, which provides us with an additional interesting note. Stars twinkle because they're gas and they send off light in pulses and they appear to twinkle in the sky. The morning star, or if you go out early one morning and see Venus, it's a steady light that doesn't blink because it's a planet and not a star. But that also plays into Christ as our morning star and that his light is constant. But the morning star heralds the coming of a new day while it's still dark out. And so in the early morning before the sun has risen, you can see the bright morning star. That light shining in the darkness is like Christ. The world is dark, the world is lost, and Christ has brought his light into the world, and it's shining in the darkness, showing us the way to the kingdom of God. And so having the morning star over his head on this particular morning as we're getting ready to enter Jerusalem to walk through his last week as a human is an important part of the painting. Also, so just looking at the painting now, you can see that there's two groups of people. We have on the left the group of disciples around Christ. Christ is the tallest figure in the grouping. He's wearing blue robes, which are blue is the color of divinity. And he's standing there in the early morning light, and all of the focus is on him. All of the disciples are looking at him. And then we look at the group over on the right side of the painting that are still coming up the hill, and they're looking at Christ, kind of concerned and anxious looks on their faces if you zero in on them. And that's because they see that Christ is weeping, and I'm sure that was a cause of concern for them. But you'll also notice that there's a gap in between the two groups. And that gap is for us, the viewer, to enter into the scene, particularly if you saw this in its life-size form. You would be able to stand right in that spot and kind of enter into the story of the picture and be present. On the far left of the painting, we have a third group of people far off in the distance. But if you zero in on them, you can see that several of them are carrying palm branches. And we have the donkey who's coming up the hill. This grouping is to foreshadow that shortly it will be Palm Sunday and that Christ will be making the triumphal entry into Jerusalem. As the disciples are getting ready to come down into Jerusalem to celebrate Passover, and as Christ is preparing himself for these events that are going to be occurring shortly, and as he looks down over the city of Jerusalem and is just struck with sadness for Jerusalem, knowing what is to come and what her history, what history holds for her. So Simonet was a deeply religious man, and he wished to paint Christ at his most human moment. And he thought, this is it. This is his most human, when he's standing and he's overcome with love and concern for the lost that lie below him in Jerusalem. And he weeps. He weeps knowing that the leadership that's in Jerusalem that should know him, should have recognized him, don't. They don't recognize that their Messiah is now in their midst, and he knows that they're going to reject him. He weeps because he knows that they're going to suffer for that. He knows that in AD 70, the temple will be destroyed and a lot of Jerusalem with it when Rome invades and plunders the city. He weeps for the lost, for the nation that's been God's chosen people, but they failed to recognize that God was amongst them during his lifetime. So when he sees Jerusalem spread out before him, he weeps. I'm going to, at this point, read you a couple of verses that describe the scene that we're examining in the painting. And then after that, I will be leading us in a contemplation of the work. So I would suggest that you just admire the painting while we go through allow the painting to be the focus of your meditation and to take you into that spot and into that slice of Christ's life as we meditate on these verses. If I'll be pausing during the contemplation sections between to give you some time, but if you want to spend more time, you have more time this morning or this afternoon or whenever you're listening to this, to take more time, go ahead and pause the video and then you can continue when you're ready. So I'm going to read you sections from Luke 19 and from Matthew 23 that describe this moment. And when he drew near and saw the city, he wept over it, saying, "Would that you, even you, had known on this day the things that make for peace, but now they are hidden from your eyes. For the days will come upon you when your enemies will set up a barricade around you and surround you and hem you in on every side and tear you down to the ground, you and your children within you. And they will not leave one stone upon another in you because you did not know the time of your visitation. O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones all those God sends to her, how often have I wanted to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks beneath her wings, but you wouldn't let me. And now your house is left to you, desolate. For I tell you this, you will never see me again until you are ready to welcome the one sent to you from God." Christ weeps for the lost. God, soften my heart so that it also breaks when I encounter the lost and the broken. The lost and the broken in my family, the lost and the broken in my community, the lost and the broken in my nation. Soften my heart toward those who suffer around the world. And especially as I view this painting, I pray for those who are lost and broken in Jerusalem, where much has changed and much stays the same. We still do not know the things that make for peace. Show us, Lord. Let peace come to this broken land. Christ weeps that the religious leaders who were charged with the spiritual care of their people didn't recognize God in their midst. God, protect me from false pride that blinds. Protect me from fear that saps my faith. Open my eyes to see you moving. Open my heart so that I can join in that movement. Open the eyes of the leaders of your church that they can see afresh with your eyes, your heart, and lead your people. Christ weeps for the coming destruction of the temple, where God would dwell and meet with the people, and he wept for the coming suffering of his people. God, I thank you that you became flesh and dwelt among us, and that we beheld your glory full of grace and truth, and that now with Christ as the cornerstone, we are being built together into a dwelling place for God.
That brings us to a close on this first visual devotional. The next devotional is based on the painting by Anthony van Dyck entitled The Entry of Christ into Jerusalem. And now that you've experienced a visual devotional, let me add some background. Before the emergence of the printing press, and before the Bible was written in the language of the people, most didn't have access to the scriptures outside of sermons and art. Paintings served as a vehicle for many to experience what many of us now experience when reading an inspiring portion of scripture, listening to a great sermon, and sensing the voice of God speaking to us. You'll come to see that the masterpieces aren't only great works of art, but incredible expressions of spiritual truth. You should also be grateful for your possession of a complete and fully accessible copy of the scriptures. Now, Kelly is an educator, and I was a pastor. In those roles, Kelly and I have had our perspective enriched by our journey into art. Kelly has always loved art, and it was translated into a tool to use in education. Her interest has shown me that art is essentially a sermon on canvas. As I began to look at art, it became apparent that the way to understand art was similar to the way we attempt to understand the Bible. Art needed exegesis. There is a need to understand context and symbolism and how those things were used to tell the gospel story. There is a language to art. If you want to know more about that, you can visit kellybagdanoff.com and specifically the article entitled Entering the Conversation That Is Art, where she will introduce you to the concept that art is a visual language, and to appreciate art, we must fully learn its language. This is our first online project, but we desire to produce much more. Thanks for your interest in this series, and we hope you'd be interested in what we continue to do with this project. Not only will we be producing devotional material like this one for Eastertide and Christmas, but our main project will be an art history curriculum that we will be rolling out starting this late spring, early summer. Here are some simple things that would help us a great deal. First, if you could just visit kellybagdanoff.com and subscribe to the blog email list, this will keep you abreast of all of our future work. Spend some time at the site and you will find a lot of helpful content, especially if you're a teacher, and especially if you know a teacher. Number two, share the devotional with your friends and family. Third, you can share the devotional on your social media accounts. We'd find that very helpful. Number four, purchase the devotional for a friend or a family member. And you can use this devotional in your small group, your Bible study, your Sunday school class. Also, we'd encourage you to share it with your pastor. Finally, if you cannot afford to purchase this devotional, we want you to have it free of charge. Simply drop us an email at kbagdanoff@gmail.com or steve@stevebagdanoff.com, and we will gladly forward you the instructions to access the devotional.